We are back again with On The Money Line, a podcast by MMA Play 365. I'm your host, Newsom, and we're back at the UFC Apex for UFC Vegas 33. This card is very thin from a name value perspective, and even the main event between Uriah Hall and Sean Strickland has surprised a lot of fans too. I personally think it's going to be a fun fight though. The card has also lost quite a lot of fights over the last few weeks as well. Some fighters have received replacement opponents and some haven't. However, we are still left with 13 fights remaining. It's a good job the card opened with 15 to 16 fights. But what we lack in name value, we normally get compensated with great fights. Let's see what this weekend brings. But just before we get into the breakdowns, as always, there's a few things to mention in regards to MMA Play 365. The last event was very hit and miss. We did drop bets on Ian Heinisch, who honestly shocked me with his performance and the inability to establish himself against Imavov. We also lost on Kyler Phillips, and again, another disappointing performance as he completely blew his gas tank in round one, and then two judges got that first round scored incorrectly as well. The fight should have ended a draw, but that's the fight game. However, the money back guarantee dog of the week was the damage himself, Darren Elkins, who finished Derek Minna, and 50% of the fun parlay options won too, so it was a mixed weekend. Remember, we have multiple packages on the MMA Play 365 website for all the UFC betting advice and DraftKings FanDuel advice that you'll ever need. We also have various subscription lengths and options too, so to see our full service list, please go and visit mmaplay365.com for more information or to sign up today. And let's go, let's break down some fights. In the main event, we've got Uriah Hall versus Sean Strickland. Strickland is currently the minus 220 favourite. The comeback on Hall at plus 180 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, I do think the line's a little bit too wide, if I'm being honest. I think the value sits with the underdog in Uriah Hall at plus 180. I understand for sure why Sean Strickland's the favourite. I'll talk about that shortly, but the line has gone too far and I just think it's a little bit too wide. So if you're asking me which is the better bet inside out of the two fighters, I'd say the plus 180 of Uriah Hall is a better bet than the minus 220 of Sean Strickland. And as for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, I honestly don't think it's going to move too much, if I'm being honest. If it does go in any direction, I would say at this point that I think more people might bet on Hall at plus 180 just because of the danger that he poses, but I don't think that it's going to ping off in any one direction, and I expect on Saturday night both fighters to step in the cage with the betting line sitting roughly where they're at right about now. And as for how the fight plays out, it's a really good fight. I actually like it quite a lot. As a main event, it's a little bit questionable, and I do understand that, but it's going to be a fun fight. Both fighters like to stand and strike, so I would be surprised to see any wrestling and grappling to a large extent. There might be a little bit here and there, just naturally because it's an MMA fight, but the fight is going to be won and lost on the feet. And it's really interesting, actually, when you look at the numbers of both fighters. You've got Sean Strickland that's landing at a much higher clip. He gets hit much less than what he lands himself, whereas Uriah Hall, statistically, he gets hit slightly more than he delivers on his opponent. So that's a concern, because we do have Strickland that's pumping out high volume over a five-round fight, a fighter that does have good cardio. That does have to give him some advantages inside the cage, but I have got a couple of concerns from Strickland's side as well as Hall as well. So in Strickland's last fight against Christoph Yotko, I bet on Sean Strickland in that fight. I was confident he was going to go out there and perform, and he did get the job done, but there were moments in that fight where he didn't look his usual self. Yotko was landing some good strikes on him, especially after Yotko had a bad first round as well. Yotko went into round two and three, he landed a little bit more than what he did in round one, and he seemed to feel his way into the fight. Now, like I say, Strickland still won the fight, no problem, but it is moments like that where I think if Yotko was able to get through the guard and land some good strikes on Strickland, then Hall should be able to as well. And the difference between when Hall hits you and Yotko hits you is completely different. You know, Hall's got a ton of natural power, he can knock you out, but Hall's also got kicks, he uses kicks a lot as well, whereas Yotko, he was throwing kicks, of course he was, but it was the punches that were getting through. If Hall's mixing things up with his kicks and his punches as well, he's just going to have a much better chance of landing something clean on Strickland. And Strickland has only been knocked out once before, but Uriah Hall's got that sort of power where it doesn't matter if his opponent hasn't been knocked out before or has only been knocked out a small number of times. He's got natural power to knock a human being out. So I do have concerns from Strickland's perspective. But then bouncing back to Hall, Hall's last fight against Chris Weidman, I think we can pretty much chalk that off. Not a lot happened. Obviously, Weidman suffered that horrific leg break pretty much at the start of the fight before the fight could even get flowing. But the fight before that was against Anderson Silva in a 5-round fight. Now, if you go back and watch that fight, Silva had some really good moments early in that fight. And this is the ghost of Anderson Silva, the Anderson Silva that's way past his prime, that is on a decline and no longer fighting in the UFC anymore. And Silva was having some success early on against Hall. Hall did eventually knock him out because he's got that raw power. He did go into round four though, so again, that's a positive. If Hall is able to knock a fighter out in round four in a 5-round fight, then that does put him in good stead in this fight as well. But the concerns are the fact that Anderson Silva was able to look good in the early moments against Hall. And I think if Silva's able to look good in those early moments, and remember it's the 2020 version of Anderson Silva, then I think Sean Strickland can as well. But actually, when you're looking at this fight overall, it's a 5-round fight. You've got Sean Strickland that's got good cardio, and you've got Sean Strickland that pumps out a nice number of volume. But Uriah Hall isn't exactly low volume himself. He doesn't exactly have bad cardio either. He's going to be able to go 5 rounds. Like I said, he knocked Anderson Silva out in round 4, which is definitely something to look out for, because he is finding those knockout finishes late in a 5-round fight. But then from Hall's perspective, he's got that fight-ending power. I think he's got more tools to use in this fight as well in regards to his kicks. And that's not only going to help his volume, but it's also going to be able to allow him to really mix things up and keep Strickland guessing at what's coming next. And honestly, a likely outcome in this fight is Sean Strickland just landing more volume over 5 rounds, potentially stopping Uriah Hall late if he's really tagged Hall up with a lot of volume. But I am going to side with the underdog in this fight. I just like the fact that Hall is a little bit more dynamic on the feet. He will mix in his kicks with his punches, and he has that fight-ending power and fight-ending power late into a fight as well. And then when you look at the line and is a plus 180 underdog, I just have to side with Uriah Hall here. I'm picking Uriah Hall to win this fight. And in the next fight in the co-main event, with all the many co-main events that we've had on this card so far with the chopping and changing, I really hope that this is the last one that we get. We've got Kyung Ho Kang versus Rani Yahya. Kang is currently the minus 135 favourite. The comeback on Yahya at plus 115. As the underdog. Now, as for where the value is on the betting line, again, I think the value sits with the underdog in Yahya at plus 115. I think the layoff from Kang, he's not fought in almost 3 years, along with the stylistic advantages that Yahya's going to have in this fight, which I'll talk about very soon. I do think that the plus money on Yahya is the value side. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, I think it's going to fluctuate, which it has a little bit. We have seen Kang up at minus 150. Money came back in on Yahya, but also, the age of Yahya and the fact that Kang is going to have some physical advantages, I think, will produce more bets from a public perspective. And that should keep the line from closing into a pick'em or flipping onto the side of Yahya. Ultimately, when both fighters step inside the cage on Saturday night, I do think the betting lines are going to be quite similar to where they're sitting now. But I also wouldn't be shocked for Kang to be sat at around minus 150. I think if it is going to move, if the line is going to move between now and fight night, it is going to be in the favour of Kang, but I don't think it's going to move too much. Now, as for how this fight plays out, I've already touched upon two really important factors in this fight from both sides. So Kang hasn't fought in almost 3 years, so that's a long layoff. I'm not too sure why he hasn't fought. Yahya is getting up in age at this point. He is only 3 years older than Kang. That is worth mentioning. But Kang's definitely in his physical peak. Talking of physicality, he's going to be taller. He's going to be longer. He might be stronger as well. So there's definitely some things to take into consideration from both sides. Now, when you analyse this fight and look at it from a stylistic perspective, I feel that Rani Yahya has got a lot of advantages in this fight. Sure, he's not going to be there from a physical perspective, like I've already mentioned, is going to be the shorter fighter, but actually that's not a bad thing for somebody like Rani Yahya, who's going to want and going to need to get takedowns in this fight because he's going to be closer to the hips, closer to the legs of Kang, because he's a little bit shorter, and that helps his game. Now, from Kang's perspective, Kang wins a lot of his fights in the UFC at this level because of his wrestling and top control. He's able to take fighters down, he's got really nice wrestling, and he's able to control topside in a top position because more often than not, he's the better grappler, especially topside. However, here, he's got to have a different game plan because he can't go looking for takedowns against Rani Yahya unless he gets Yahya tired first. And you even saw when Yahya fought Ricky Simon, who's a phenomenal wrestler himself. Simon was scoring takedowns, but he was taking Yahya down and backing straight back out of his guard. Now, that's an option for Kang, but it's not really his style. Whereas Ricky Simon can just rinse and repeat takedowns, and he does do that in a lot of his fights. What Kang tends to do is get a takedown and then stay on the mat for as long as possible. But that runs you into so many risks fighting somebody like Yahya, who is a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. And you just do not want to go to the mat with him. Even if Yahya's on bottom, he's fine with that. He's not necessarily going to throw up many arm bars or triangles and cause a submission threat off his back. But what he will do is sweep and reverse you, put himself on top. And that's where he's an absolute nightmare. So from Kang's perspective, he's got to try and stay long in this fight. He's got to try and stick on the outside and just beat Yahya up on the feet in the striking department. And actually, if Kang can keep this fight vertical, then I don't see Yahya winning this fight at all. Kang will be the better technical striker, probably got more power as well. But having said that, Yahya's Muay Thai isn't too bad. It's improved over the years. He's going to be competitive. But the main factor for me in this fight is that when Kang has fought fighters that do have some takedowns in them, he can be taken down. Brandon Davis took him down. Ricardo Ramos took him down. Guido Canetti took him down. So when he's fighting fighters that they're not necessarily prolific wrestlers, but do have a form of wrestling pedigree in them, he can be taken down. And Rani Yahya takes pretty much every single fighter that he fights down. The only fighter that he really struggled against was Ricky Simon. But as we've already mentioned, Ricky Simon is a phenomenal wrestler, explosive, really fast movement himself. So that fight, again, stylistically was really difficult for Yahya. And I actually bet Ricky Simon in that fight as well, which was a nice cash. But back to this fight, I just think that Kang's going to be able to be taken down in this fight. I think Yahya is going to be able to close the distance. I think Yahya, although he might be at a slight disadvantage on the feet, striking, he's going to be competitive. He'll be able to close the distance. He'll be able to take Kang down. I'm not sure if he definitely gets Kang out of there, but I do think he gets him down and spends enough top control time to win some rounds early. I do worry for Yahya if he can't get him out in those round one or round two rounds, though, the early rounds, because if this gets into round three, then I do suspect the cardio of Kang will be better than Yahya. But if Yahya could even just remain safe in round three, should it get there, if he has won the opening two rounds, then he should be winning a 29-28 on the scorecards anyway. I think that Yahya's got a number of advantages from a stylistic perspective in this fight. I'm picking Rani Yahya to win this fight. And in the next fight, we've got Gloria De Paula versus Cheyenne Baze. Baze is currently the minus 160 favourite. The comeback on De Paula at plus 140 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, for the third time in a row, I think the value sits with the underdog in De Paula at plus 140. I think the fight is going to play out much closer than the betting line suggests. I think from De Paula's perspective, she's got a decent fight ahead of her. Again, I will talk about that very shortly, but ultimately, I think the line should be much closer than what it is. The value side, the better side to bet at this moment is De Paula at plus 140. As for where the betting lines move throughout fight week, I do think the lines continue to close. The trend over the last few days has been money on De Paula. She was sitting at plus 175 at one point with Baze at around plus 200, so a lot of money is coming on De Paula. I agree with that trend. I think it does continue. I don't think we see a pick'em or anything come fight night on Saturday night, but I do think the lines will be much closer. I think Baze may sit at around minus 135, minus 140, with De Paula roughly around plus 125, plus 130. Now, as for how this fight plays out, I do think that both fighters have got a fight that they're going to want in this fight. And what I mean by that is, when you look at both of their UFC debuts, you've got De Paula losing to Jinyu Fry. She got taken down twice. She was controlled on the mat. And then you've got Cheyenne Baze that fought Montserrat Ruiz, who got taken down 4 times and lost the fight. Now, both fighters do appear to be relatively well-rounded. Both fighters do appear that they can get a little bit stuck if they're taken down. But in this fight, both fighters, I feel, are going to stand and strike. I think the fight's won and lost in the striking department. And like I've already said, both fighters will want that. And it'll actually make for a good fight as well. I think Baez is definitely the more aggressive forward pressure fighter, likes to get in your face, likes to stand and scrap, and if there's a wild exchange inside boxing range, she's all for that. Whereas De Paula, she looks to be more technical, looks to be in and out of range. If she has to fight on the back foot a little bit, so be it. She'll pop some nice straight strikes out there. She'll throw some kicks, mix some kicks in there as well. And I think that's the type of fight we've got. I think Baez will be the aggressor. She will be the one pushing forwards for the majority of the fight. But the striking on the back foot and the moments that De Paula will get aggressive, I think will allow her to get an edge in this fight. I think when both fighters come together, when they clinch up, because Baez will crash into her opponent and go against the cage. When they're in the clinch, tied up against the cage, De Paula's got decent Muay Thai there. She'll get a plum clinch. She'll look to land knees to the body and knees to the head along with some elbows. I think Baez is going to be slightly more physical in regards to strength, but De Paula's going to have more technique, and I think the technique side of it is going to outweigh the physicality of Baez, because to me, it feels like De Paula is going to be landing more volume throughout the fight, even if it does mean that she's on the back foot a little bit. And listen, someone like Lyoto Machida has made a successful career out of fighting on the back foot effectively, so it's not necessarily always the forward pressure aggressive fighter that is going to score well on the scorecard should it go there. I think De Paula's going to be defensive in this fight. I think she's going to land a lot of volume, and when they do come forwards and clash and crash into each other, I think De Paula's going to do the slightly better work inside the clinch as well. The fight's going to be really close though, because of that forward pressure and aggression of Baez. It will still have some bearing on the scorecards. But for me, if this fight does stay standing, if it is a fight that's won and lost on the feet, if Baez doesn't surprise us and looks to wrestle and get topside of De Paula, which, to be honest, wouldn't be a bad path to victory. But if I am right in saying that the fight's won and lost on the feet, I do think the more technical fighter is Gloria De Paula. I do think that she's going to be able to land slightly more volume. I'm picking Gloria De Paula to win this fight. And in the next fight, at the time of recording this podcast, this fight was only made last night. We've got Nicholas Stoltzer versus Jared Gooden. Stoltz is currently the minus 200 favourite. The comeback on Gooden at plus 170 as the underdog. It is worth just mentioning at this point that there is only one book that I can see with this betting line. As I said, the fight was made last night, so not many bookies will have the line at the time of recording this podcast. But the value on the current betting line for me does sit with the favourite in Stoltzer. It's really short notice for Jared Gooden. I'm sure he's ready. I'm sure he's stayed ready. But I do think that Stoltzer has got some stylistic advantages. He's had a full camp, whereas Jared Gooden hasn't. He's stepping in on less than a week's notice. So you have to think that the value at minus 200 is on Stoltzer. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, obviously, like I've said, we've got to wait for other bookies to come through with a betting line. It is worth noting, though, that Jared Gooden did open at that one book that I'm talking about as a minus 130 favourite. Stoltzer was plus 110 as the underdog, but the line lasted about 20 minutes, half an hour before it flipped, and I've woken up this morning and now Stoltzer sitting at minus 200. It's going to be interesting to see what happens when other books come into the market. I do actually think the lines close up a little bit though. I think there will be some money on that plus 170 line of Gooden. I think it will close up, but I don't think it's going to get anywhere close to a pick, and I don't think there's going to be a line flip. I think Stoltzer's probably going to enter the fight roughly around a minus 160 favourite, with Jared Gooden sitting at around plus 150. Now, as for how the fight plays out, again, I think it's going to be a fight that's won and lost on the feet. I think if any fighter out of the two decided to mix things up and shoot for a takedown, it is probably more likely to be Stoltzer, especially with Gooden taking this fight on short notice. Trying to come into this fight with a wrestling heavy game plan probably isn't the best idea, considering he hasn't had a lot of time to prepare. But from Stoltzer's perspective, if he does start shooting takedowns at Gooden for me, he's got decent takedown defense. He can be got at eventually, but he's got good balance and he can defend a takedown. So I don't think that any takedowns, if there is any, from Stoltz, or is going to have much bearing on the result of the fight. I think the fight, as I've already mentioned, is going to be won and lost on the feet. And that's where Gooden's good. So Stoltz does have to be careful. Gooden's got decent boxing. He's got power as well. But for me, like I say, Stoltz has had the full fight camp. He has had a full preparation to step inside the cage for 15 minutes. And Stoltz's kickboxing is actually pretty good as well. And that's another reason why I like him in this fight, because I think whereas Gooden's quite boxing heavy, Stoltz, he will mix in kicks with his punches. He is more of a kickboxer. So again, like I mentioned with Uriah Hall, he's just got more of a varied attack. He's got more tools to use inside the cage. He's going to be slightly more dynamic. He will be throwing kicks to the body, to the legs, to the head, but he will be mixing that up with his boxing combinations. I think the fight could potentially be close if it goes three rounds, especially if Gooden does get off to a good start and then fades. Like I say, it's a short notice fight. There'd be nothing wrong with that. It'd just be a natural thing. So the fight could end up playing out close in some scenarios, but I just have to favour the fighter that was preparing for already a really good striker in Munir Lazez. Now he's got another striker in Jared Gooden on short notice. There's a lot of upside for Stoltz, in my opinion, in this fight, whereas Jared Gooden, just because of the short notice replacement and the preparation, that side of things, there is a few red flags on him from that perspective. I am going to be siding with Stoltz. I'm picking Nicholas Stoltz to win this fight. And in the next fight, we've got Ryan Benoit versus Zaruk Adesanya. Benoit is currently the minus 135 favourite. The comeback on Adeshev at plus 115 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, a couple of days ago on Twitter, I did tweet out that there's a lot of live underdogs. I do think that is the case, and I think Adeshev is another one of them. I think the value side here is the plus money on Adeshev. Benoit has just been a little bit hit and miss in his UFC career so far. I will talk about that very shortly. But Adeshev, he did show moments in his last fight that he is a good fighter. I do think that the line should be at least a pick'em. Therefore, the plus money side of Adeshev is the value side, in my opinion. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, I don't think it's going to move too much, but it does appear that when the lines close up a little bit too much, money seems to come back in on Benoit, pushing him back out to where he's sitting roughly right about now. And I think that is going to continue throughout fight week. I think if Adeshev gets to plus 110 or plus 105, we'll just see a little bit of influx of money coming in from Benoit, pushing him back to where he is right about now. Now, as for how this fight plays out, I've just touched upon it momentarily there. I do think that Ryan Benoit is just really hit and miss. Like, in some fights, he looks like he's got real promise, like he could make moves and make his way up the division. But then in other fights, he just looks a little bit flat. The performances aren't there. In his last five fights in the UFC, he is 2-3. 1-2, lost 3. But the two wins he's got are against Ashkan Mokhtarian and Freddy Serrano. Neither were UFC caliber. Neither are in the UFC anymore. His losses, Brandon Moreno, fair enough. You know, you can't knock that. He's the current world champion. But then Haley Alatang, Tim Elliott, he was beaten relatively decisively, in my opinion. Again, in those fights, he started well. He faded off. It's a performance issue. So I just have a really tough time of trusting Ryan Benoit, just because I don't know what I'm going to see from him inside the cage. Is he going to put on a spectacular performance? Is he going to be flat? Is he going to have a half and half, starting well, finishing badly? I just don't know what to expect from him. And then from Adeshev's perspective, I did a lot of tape on Adeshev pre-UFC when he got signed into the UFC to fight Tyson Nam. And actually, coming from a kickboxing background and then picking up the wrestling and the grappling, I actually really liked what I saw from him in Bellator, and I thought that he was going to be a solid fighter. Then he comes into the fight against Tyson Nam and he gets knocked out in round one. But the things you've got to consider in that fight is that Adeshev went up a weight class on about 24 to 48 hours notice. You can tell, no disrespect, that he got up from the sofa. He wasn't in shape. He did look like he was carrying much more weight than usual. So I do think you have to give him a bit of a pass with that. But then he comes in against Suma Derji, who is a really good, long, solid striker himself. And Maderji started that fight well. He started putting it on Adeshev. But Adeshev actually weathered a bit of a storm in that fight, came back and really put on a good performance, to the point where halfway through the fight, you're thinking, the tide's turned, Adeshev might be able to push through this and get a decision win. It wasn't to be. Suma Derji was the better striker on the night. But Suma Derji, like I say, is really long, awkward and dynamic, and he is a really good fighter and a fighter to watch out for. Whereas Benoit can be a good fighter, and he is good on the feet at times when we see him. he is going to be much shorter than what Sumudurji was, which means that Adashev's not going to be constantly having to try and close that distance and get inside to land. Adashev's going to have someone on his level that he's going to be able to fight from an equal perspective, from a physical perspective. And I think that Adashev's just going to be the quicker fighter in and out of range. I think he's going to land slightly more volume, but land slightly more volume over the period of 15 minutes, again, should it go that far. Whereas Benoit, I think, is going to start quite fast, and I think he'll fade with the movement of Adashev. From a wrestling perspective, Benoit's got advantages there, in my opinion, but he doesn't usually go to that wrestling too often, and I don't think Adashev's going to be that easy to take down. I think he's going to have a good get-up game as well. He's very scrambly, Adashev, and he won't accept being taken down and being flattened out on his back and accepting that bottom position. So I do think it's a fight that's going to be won and lost on the feet. I think that Adashev's going to have a speed advantage and a movement advantage. I think it's going to be close early on. I expect Adashev to really grow into the fight the longer it goes on, if he's obviously not finished early in this fight, which I don't think he's going to be. So I do think that there's some upside on Adashev, enough upside to say that he's the better bet at plus money. I'm picking Saruk Adashev to win this fight. And in the next fight, we've got the return of Brian Barberena versus Jason Witt. Barberena is currently the minus 260 favourite. The comeback on Witt at plus 220 as the underdog. As for where the value is in this fight, I think the value sits with the favourite, Brian Barberena. I understand why the line is this wide. And honestly, if Barberena was sitting at around minus 300, minus 325, I still wouldn't be shocked at that sort of betting line. I think he's got a lot of advantages in this fight, which I'll talk about very shortly. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, I do think that the money will continue to come in on Barberena. I think even if people aren't playing Barberena straight, he's going to be in a lot of public parlays. That's going to increase the betting line. I just don't think there's going to be many people queuing up to bet Jason Witt at plus 220. And those two things combined should push the line out a little bit more, should widen it a little bit more. I think Barberena's going to close at around the minus 300 mark. Now, as for how this fight plays out, the only concern I really have from Barberena's perspective is he's had a tough time of it over the last couple of years with injuries, surgery, fighting hurt. He did come back in 2020 last year against Anthony Ivey and beat Ivey relatively comfortably. You know, they didn't have a lot of adversity in that fight to overcome. And actually talking about Anthony Ivey, and from an opponent perspective, it actually leads into a really good point here, because it's very obvious looking at Brian Barberena's record that when he fights a certain level of opponent, he has a really good time inside the cage and he'll get a win. But it's when he takes the big step ups in competition is where he falls short. So if you go down his record and look, his last fight and win was Anthony Ivey. Anthony Ivey no longer with the UFC. Then you've got two losses prior to that. Randy Brown, who's a decent mid-level fighter. Vicente Luque, who's a top fighter. Then before that, he beat Jake Ellenberger. Ellenberger was a good fighter in his prime, but that wasn't prime Jake Ellenberger. A loss to Leon Edwards. Then he beat Joe Proctor before that. Joe Proctor, again, relatively low-level fighter. The loss before that, Colby Covington, world-class fighter. So you're seeing a pattern here. He's losing against the top fighters with the step-ups, but he's beating the fighters that he's supposed to beat, and Jason Witt falls into that category. Witt is the fighter that he's supposed to beat. He's not at the mid-level, even like what Randy Brown is. He is more of a lower-level fighter inside the UFC, and I do expect Barberena to come into this fight and beat him as, in my opinion, he's supposed to. Jason Witt, on the other hand, he's had three fights in the UFC. The Takashi Sato fight, I think we can give him a pass for. It was a short notice debut fight, and Sato just head and shoulders above him. Then he came in and beat Cole Williams. In my opinion, Cole Williams should have never have even been in the UFC, watching tape on that fight. I'm not sure why he was called up. Then he gets knocked out by Matthew Semelsberger in round one. Not a good look. Semelsberger is not a bad fighter, but getting knocked out by him in round one, it's not a good look when you're stepping up to move into a fight with Brian Barberena. I think Barberena's just going to be better everywhere here. I think he's a better striker. He's a better wrestler, both offensively and defensively. And I think he's a better grappler. And more importantly, he's a better grinder with solid cardio. And I think that's where Brian Barberena is going to really thrive in this fight. I think Witt's going to come forward knowing that he's got to take Barberena out. He's going to get into the boxing range. Barberena can either box with him, potentially have a risk of getting knocked out himself or push forwards just that little bit more, clinch up with him, make it dirty, get a couple of takedowns, make Witt stand back up and just grind the fight out. I think Barbarina's got a ton of upside here. I think he's got advantages in every area of mixed martial arts. I'm picking Brian Barbarina to win this fight. And in the next fight, we've got Nico Montano versus Yinan Wu. Montano's currently the minus 240 favourite. The comeback on Wu at plus 200 as the underdog. As for where the value is on this betting line, I'm not sure if there is too much value, if I'm being honest, because I do understand why Montano is sitting at minus 240. But in the same respect, there is some definite concerns with Montano to maybe stay away from that minus 240. If you are asking me which is the better side to bet, I think I'd rather throw Montano in a parlay than bet the plus 200 of Yinan Wu. But like I say, I do understand the betting line that there's not too much value there either. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, the current trend is the money on Nico Montano. She was sat at minus 180, minus 190 a couple of days ago. All that money's coming in her, pushed her to minus 240, minus 250 in some spots as well. So a lot of money in on Montano, but I do think that that's going to subside a little bit. I don't think the line's going to now move in any direction quite heavily. I don't think Montano is going to end up at minus 300, and I don't think she's going to end up back at minus 180, minus 190. I think the line's going to stay roughly where it is right about now. Now, as for how this fight plays out, there is a couple of concerns, as I've just touched upon, with Nico Montano, and it's crazy to think that she's actually only had two fights in the UFC. Even when I was looking back at the record, I was sure that she'd had three, four fights, but she hasn't. She fought for that world title against Roxanne Modafferi. And again, it's easy to forget that she was a world champion as well, obviously, before Shevchenko took over. And then she fought Juliana Pena in her last fight. Now, the issue I have is when you go and watch the Roxanne Modafferi fight, Modafferi had a lot of good moments in that fight. Moments where she was looking like the better wrestler. She was tagging Montano up, and Montano in moments looked a little lost, but she ended up grinding through and getting the decision. And I don't think that Modafferi, although she's a UFC caliber fighter, I don't think she's any sort of dynamic, explosive fighter. I think that somebody like Montano should have been pretty much running through Modafferi. So the fact that she didn't is definitely a cause for concern. But then she goes in there and fights Juliana Pena and actually looks really good, really improved. She takes Pena down a couple of times early in the fight, wins round one. Pena ends up coming back in round two, and round three was back and forth. It was a close fight. And for me, I rate Juliana Pena quite highly in the division. So the fact that Montano was competitive with Juliana Pena tells me that she does have skills and abilities. But it also tells me, after watching the Roxanne Modafferi fight, that she might be one of those fighters that just fights to the level of her opponent. If her opponent's much better than her, she'll improve her game and she'll look better inside the cage. But if her opponent's not as good as her from a skill perspective, then she'll end up not fighting to her full potential. And that's always a bit of a concern when you're looking at a fighter and you're looking at potentially a bet and stuff like that. But then you look onto Yinan Wu. Yinan Wu, she's big, she's physical, she's strong, she's got decent striking, but she does have holes in that wrestling and grappling, especially from a defensive perspective. Now, this is where Nico Montano could really exploit Yinan Wu, and this is why I think that the betting line is right to be as wide as what it is. And that's because Nico Montano, if she comes into this fight like she came into the fight against Pena, looking for takedowns and top control, she's going to have a ton of success and she's probably going to win the fight relatively comfortably. Yinan Wu looks like the type of fighter as well that once she's taken down three or four times, that she'll just start accepting position because she's struggling to consistently get back up to her feet. She's going to be difficult to take down early and keep down early, but it's up to Montano to keep on with that wrestling and grappling game plan. And if she does that, then that's where she's going to have the advantages. I think on the feet, Wu's the better striker. I think she'll tag Montano up. But again, if she starts really getting ahead on the striking, it's going to force that game plan, that wrestling and grappling game plan of Montano. So it's almost a catch-22 for Yinan Wu, because where she's better, where she's going to have success, is ultimately going to cause her downfall in this fight, if that makes sense. I think that if the fight is won and lost on the feet, if Montano either doesn't or can't take Yinan Wu down, Yinan Wu's going to win this fight quite comfortably. The plus 200 will look like a steal of the century, but this is mixed martial arts. I think Montano is going to mix things up. I think she is going to score takedowns throughout the fight. I think she's going to have topside control that's going to allow her to win minutes of the rounds and ultimately win the rounds. I'm picking Nico Montano to win this fight. And in the next fight, we've got the debut of two fighters that performed well in the contender series. We've got Colin Anglin versus Melsik Bagdasarian. Bagdasarian is currently the minus 140 favourite, the comeback on Angling at plus 120 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, I do think the value sits with Bagdasarian. I think that he's going to have some stylistic advantages, which we'll get into shortly. I do think that the minus 140 is the better bet than the plus 120 of Colin Angling as the underdog. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, there's been a lot of fluctuation with this betting line. At the start, Bagdasarian opened up a bigger favourite. The money came back in on Angling, which I completely understand, but then Bagdasarian started having money come back in on him because his line got so low, and it's just been fluctuating like that. I expect that to continue, but ultimately I think that with a bit of back and forth, it's going to end up where we're sitting right about now when both fighters step into the cage on Saturday night. Now, as for how this fight plays out, Bagdasarian is a really fun fighter to watch. He starts fights fast, he's got a lot of finishes early, really early in fights, really early in round one. But he did go three rounds in his contender series fight. He comes out fast and hard. He fires kicks up and down the body, legs, body, head. The kicks fire out fast as well. But he'll also burst in with punches, straight punches down the middle. He'll really mix things up in regards to his striking. He's a varied striker. He's an elusive striker. And he'll fire in from many angles. The only issue that I had with Bagdasarian from watching his contender series fight is he went that hard in round one for a finish that in rounds two and three, the volume fell off a cliff. His cardio almost fell off a cliff. He was looking really tired, a little bit more laboured. However, to counter that, and to his credit, he still did remain active throughout rounds two and three. He still did perform quite well. It's just he couldn't perform to what he performed in round one, just because round one was a complete onslaught. So that does have to be a little bit of a worry for Bagdasarian. He's got to have that in his mind that he can't go that fast and hard in round one. And maybe he only did that because it was a contender series fight and he thought that that was his best way to get a contract. Now he's in the UFC, he's got to pace it a little bit better. He can't go all out in round one because you are going to come up against a fighter that will push the pace in rounds two and three if you start slowing down and if they can weather the storm. And for me, that's Colin Angling, actually. Angling is a decent fighter. He's got good striking, decent wrestling. His background is in wrestling. So if Bagdasarian does slow down like he did in the Contender Series fight, I could genuinely see someone like Angling taking over a little bit the longer the fight goes on, really starting to take over that fight in the later rounds. And actually, that's what happened in Angling's Contender Series fight. His opponent tired out halfway into round two and Angling took over. But still, I've got question marks with Angling because he did allow moments in that third round when his opponent genuinely had nothing left. He ended up sweeping Angling on the mat, getting topside late in a fight. And it's little things like that that are concerning for me. Angling's got this wrestling background, but we don't see too much of it. And that's because I'm not sure that it's translated into MMA as much as what it should have done by now. And maybe that's something that Angling develops further in time. We saw fighters like Cejudo who had a legit ridiculous wrestling background, an Olympic wrestling background, but it took him a few fights to bridge that gap between wrestling and then MMA wrestling. So maybe that's the case with Colin Angling. But in this fight, I just feel that even if Angling does get takedowns, we saw Bagdasarian get taken down when he was tired in rounds two and three by his opponent, but he was able to pop right back up to his feet straight away. He never fell short and accepted position and was laying on his back doing nothing, just getting beaten up. He was popping straight back up even though he was fighting through that gas tank and the cardio barrier. I like Bagdasarian. I think he's the more dynamic striker. I think he can fight through adversity, especially when he's tired. And I think that he's going to be able to defend takedowns in this fight. Angling gets hit also a little bit more than what I'd like to see. That's a really bad trait to have against somebody with the striking skills of Bagdasarian. I'm picking Melsik Bagdasarian to win this fight. And in the next fight, we've got Chris Gritsmacher versus Rafa Garcia. Garcia is currently the minus 280 favourite, the comeback on Gritsmacher at plus 240 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, even though the line's wide, I think the value is absolutely on Rafa Garcia at minus 280. I think the line could potentially be even wider as well. If he was sitting at minus 350, I wouldn't have even said that was an offline. So I think that minus 280 for Rafa Garcia is definitely the better bet than the plus 240 underdog status of Chris Gritsmacher. As for where the line moves throughout fight week, it fluctuated a little bit early on, but the money's coming on Rafa Garcia, who was sitting at around minus 225. Now, obviously, obviously is minus 280. You can see all that money coming in on him. I think that'll continue as well. He is minus 300 at one other book, but I think he's going to go past that by the time it comes to fight night. I do think he will be up at around minus 325, around that sort of line. I think he's going to be in a lot of parlays. I think people will play him straight as well. So I do think that there's just going to be so much more money coming in on him from a betting perspective than the plus 240 of Chris Gritsmacher. That'll widen the line. Garcia will go into the fight north of minus 300 in my opinion. As for how this fight plays out, I think that Chris Gritsmacher is in real trouble in this fight in my opinion, because he's a fighter that in my opinion, and I promise I don't mean any disrespect with this, was never truly a UFC caliber fighter. He has won two fights inside the UFC. He did beat a declined Joe Lauzon. He did beat Abner Laveras years and years ago in the tough finale. But aside from that, I don't think, apart from the Lauzon fight, that he's looked that great in any of his fights in the UFC either. He's also a fighter that suffered with a few injuries. He's had layoffs, he's had time off. Now, in all fairness to Gritsmacher, actually the fighters that he's lost against, Chaz Skelly, Davi Ramos, Alexander Hernandez, they're not bad losses, but what all those three fighters have in common with Rafa Garcia is they beat Chris Gritsmacher in every aspect of MMA. They're all better strikers than Gritsmacher. They're all better wrestlers than Gritsmacher, both offensively and defensively. They're all better grapplers than Chris Gritsmacher. And that's the exact same case that you can make against Rafa Garcia. Garcia's just better in every area, but not just that. Garcia's got this crazy forward pressure and aggression that will break a fighter, and I think that Chris Gritsmacher at this moment is a fighter that can be broken inside the cage. We saw Alexander Hernandez break him, and you look at Garcia's debut, short notice debut against Nasrat Haqparast, who is an explosive, dynamic, powerful striker himself. Garcia was the one pushing forward throughout the entire 15 minutes. He's got a chin, he was durable, he was eating big shots, but he was firing back at Nasrat Haqparast. And honestly, all I can think about is if that's Chris Gritsmacher in that fight instead of Nasrat Haqparast, Garcia would have either put him out early or it have been an absolute bloodbath for 15 minutes. And I think that's what's going to happen here. I think Garcia is going to be the one pushing forwards. I think Gritsmacher is going to struggle to get any strikes off. I think that's just going to allow the pressure to just constantly be put on Gritsmacher with pace. I think he's going to get hit a lot. If Gritsmacher tries wrestling, I think that Rafa Garcia is going to be able to scramble. I think he'll be able to reverse a position as well. If he ends up on top of Gritsmacher, he'll be able to smother him a little bit. I don't think he'll necessarily slice through him like butter on the mat. It did take Davi Ramos a little bit of time to actually get to Chris Gritsmacher. Ultimately, he did prevail, but Davi Ramos is a legit grappler. But whichever way I look at this fight, wherever this fight takes place, whether it's won and lost on the feet, won and lost on the mat, wrestling, grappling, I just think that Rafa Garcia is going to be an absolute nightmare for Gritsmacher stylistically, physically. I don't see Gritsmacher getting his hand raised at the end of the night. I just think it's a really bad fight for him. I'm picking Rafa Garcia to win this fight. And in the next fight, this should be a fun, explosive fight. We've got Danny Chavez versus Kai Kamaka the third. Kai Kamaka is currently the slight minus 115 favorite, with the comeback on Danny Chavez, the slight minus 105 underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, it's one of those fights where the line's so close, if you've got a good read on either side, then either side is playable. Like I said, as long as you do have that good read. If you are going to push me for a value side between both fighters, I think the minus 105 and the plus money in some other places on Danny Chavez is the better bet than the minus 115 on Kai Kamaka. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, I think it's going to fluctuate. It has already. Danny Chavez opened the favourite. Kai Kamaka then became the favourite once the line flipped. Danny Chavez was up at plus 120, plus 125 in some spots. Money came tumbling back on Danny Chavez, pushing him to where he is right about now. Ultimately, I see this fluctuating between the two. I think we might even see moments where the line flips and we've got Danny Chavez the minus 115 slight favourite with Kamaka at minus 105. But it's going to be flip-flopping throughout fight week, fluctuation. I actually think it's going to close a pick 'em come fight night on Saturday night. Now, as for how this fight plays out, I could make an argument of myself that I was much higher than what I should have been on both of these fighters, but more so with Kai Kamaka. When I first watched Kai Kamaka's tape before he fought Tony Kelly, as he was signed to the UFC, I was super impressed with what I saw. I thought he was going to be a legit prospect. He looks clean, he looks crisp, he looks sharp on the feet. But actually what I feel happened is Kamaka came into the UFC and he was actually matched against fighters at his own level, and suddenly, although he's not a bad fighter, I still like him as a fighter, but suddenly he wasn't looking as dominant as what he did outside the UFC because he got matched correctly and he was put in there with fighters that would also fire back at him at the highest level in the UFC. And as for Danny Chavez, I wasn't really sure what to expect with Chavez pre-UFC, but he came into the UFC, he fought TJ Brown, he looked absolutely dominant, and honestly I think from that fight he was overvalued then going in against Jared Gordon, who you just can't forget that Jared Gordon is a good fighter, and Gordon did make it look relatively easy against Chavez, but again I think Gordon's a level above Chavez, and I think if Gordon fought Kai Kamaka, Gordon would beat him comfortably as well. So I think Chavez was just overvalued in that fight. And then because of that, I now think he's back to being undervalued in this fight. I think it's going to be a good fight, one that's likely going to be won and lost on the feet. There could be moments in wrestling, both fighters shoot takedowns sporadically, both can complete takedowns, both have got relatively decent top games, but also defensively both can get back up to the feet if they're not being totally smothered on the mat. And that's another thing, with Kai Kamaka, he was completely smothered on the mat against Jonathan Pierce, who was just better than him. Danny Chavez struggled to get up from bottom against Jared Gordon, who was just better than him. So I think the wrestling offensively and defensively, the grappling offensively and defensively will be nullified a bit in this fight. I don't think either's going to be good enough to be dominant with the defensive skills of their opponent, if that makes sense. And what that'll essentially mean is that the fight will likely be won and lost on the feet. So I feel that Kamaka, everything's a little bit tighter with him. I think he's the more technical striker. I think he will put out very fast combinations. But on the flip side, Danny Chavez is also fast when he fires out his punches as well, also mixes in combinations. But I think Chavez is slightly more aggressive and he hits slightly harder as well, and he's more willing to engage inside boxing range, which could deter Kamaka getting into any type of brawl with Chavez. The thing is with Kamaka though, he can't fight the urge to get into these brawls. He's very technical when he's inside that boxing range, but the second that punches start throwing wild, he will throw wild, and that's where you can catch him, and that's where I think that Danny Chavez is going to have some success. But the other big factor to mention in this fight is the low kicks of both fighters. So both fighters will throw low kicks. Kamaka will throw them early. He does have power behind him, but the thing is, Kamaka steps off them the longer the fight goes on. So you'll see some low kicks in round one, but if the fight goes into round three, suddenly you ain't seeing any low kicks. And it's frustrating because he can have some success with it if he stayed on it throughout the fight, but it just seems to, you know, come off a little bit. Whereas Danny Chavez will stick to that low kick throughout three rounds, powerful low kicks. And ultimately, that's the reason he beat TJ Brown, because he broke TJ Brown in that first round. He absolutely immobilized him with that lead low kick early in the fight, and from then TJ Brown was switching stances, he couldn't really plant his foot, and it was just easy for Chavez from that point. I think Chavez could get back to this in this fight, with the fight more than likely going to be won and lost on the feet and played out majoritively on the feet as well. So I think that Danny Chavez has got advantages inside those wild exchanges. I think he can hammer the low kicks from the outside and stay on that as well, and in my opinion those things added together does start to give some upside from a stylistic perspective for Chavez in this fight. I'm picking Danny Chavez to win this fight. And in the next fight, we've got Ashley Yoder versus Jinyu Fry. Yoder's currently the minus 135 favourite. The comeback on Fry at plus 115 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, I do think the value sits with the favourite here in Ashley Yoder. I think there's an argument that the betting line could be a little bit wider if Yoder was sitting at minus 150, minus 155. That would probably be the limit, but I would understand that betting line a little bit more than what I do with this one. Ultimately, I just think the minus 135 is the better bet than the plus 115 of the underdog. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, I do think that money will come in on Ashley Yoder. That is the current trend. I do think it will continue. But like I said, if we are seeing minus 150, minus 155, I think ultimately that's where it stops. I'm not sure any money would start surging in for Jinyu Fry, if I'm being honest. I think Ashley Yoder's going to close at around that minus 150 line. Now, as for how this fight plays out, as with this level in the UFC, I do think we could potentially see a close fight. It wouldn't shock me to see a close fight, a bit of back and forth, one and one going into the third round, and who wants it more type of scenario. But I have to think that pre-fight that Ashley Yoder has not only fought the better level of competition, but should have Fry covered in most areas. I think from Fry's perspective, her best chance to win this fight is to make it ugly, dirty, gritty, get a hold of Yoda, push her up against the cage. She might have some physical advantages inside the clinch in regards to strength, so that might factor in her favour if she does come into the cage with that sort of game plan. But ultimately, I think it's going to be hard to achieve that against Yoda for a full 15 minutes or even a full 10 minutes. I think Yoda's going to be the cleaner striker. She's a fighter that is still improving from fight to fight. I think she's going to be cleaner on the outside. I think when she comes in, she can box a little bit as well. Not massively prolific inside that boxing range, but I think that she will be able to have some success in this fight. And then in regards to the wrestling, I think Yoda's going to have advantages there offensively and defensively. And when the fight hits the mat, I think Yoda's really tricky on the mat as well. I personally think that Yoda has fought better versions of Jinyu Fry in the UFC. Fighters in some fights that she's lost as well, but that she's still being competitive enough for me to know that a lesser version of that fighter like Jinyu Fry, and I don't mean any disrespect with that, that Yoda will be able to handle herself and come through with a victory. I think that the fight is going to be a true mixed martial arts fight. We're going to see moments on the feet, moments in the clinch, moments on the mat, and I just feel that Yoda is better in more areas than Jinyu Fry. I'm picking Ashley Yoda to win this fight. And in the next fight, in the People's Main Event, I've got no idea why this fight is buried so far down in a card like this. We've got Trevin Jones versus Ronnie Lawrence. This is the best fight on the card, in my opinion. We've got Ronnie Lawrence currently as the minus 150 favourite, the comeback on Jones at plus 130 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, the current betting line, I think the value is slightly sitting with the favourite in Ronnie Lawrence at minus 150. I did bet on Ronnie Lawrence in his UFC debut against Vince Cachero around this sort of betting line, and I honestly didn't think we would see this sort of betting line on Lawrence for a good few fights until he really starts stepping up seriously in those levels in competition. But here we are again, minus 150, I think he's the value side. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, I do think it's going to fluctuate, and I think we see more money coming in on Trevin Jones. The one thing you've got to think about is Ronnie Lawrence was sitting at around minus 200 a few days ago, with Trevin Jones at around plus 175. So much money came in on Trevin Jones to the point where Ronnie Lawrence in some books actually went down to around minus 133. But more money's come back in on him. And I think we've hit that brick wall with the betting line. I think the money will keep coming in on Jones until Lawrence is around the minus 130 mark. And then people will bet it back up to around minus 150. And ultimately, because of that, I think that's where the betting line's going to close when they step into the cage on Saturday night. Now, as for how this fight plays out, it's such a good fight. You've got Ronnie Lawrence in his last two fights, obviously his UFC debut and his Contender Series fight. He's attempted 26 takedowns and completed 20 of them. He's absolutely relentless with those takedown attempts, and I don't believe he's even got a wrestling background. I think his background's actually in karate, which you can see he's got really good movement on the feet. He can slide into that karate stance from time to time. He will throw kicks, he'll throw spinning attacks. So I actually think the background's karate, and he's just suddenly found that he's a good wrestler in that he can complete a lot of takedowns, and he's got the cardio to be relentless as well. He never really looks tired. And then on the flip side here, despite Trevin Jones knocking out his last two opponents and looking like he's just this raw power striker, actually the first martial art of Trevin Jones was Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. He's a BJJ black belt. He's a 7x no-gi champion. So Trevin Jones has got good grappling on paper himself. So it's going to be interesting, because Lawrence is going to be shooting a lot of takedowns in this fight. I actually think the best path to victory for Trevin Jones is to knock Ronnie Lawrence out. So Lawrence, for me, is going to be pushing those takedowns and the grappling. And then Trevin Jones, we're going to see Trevin Jones meet him on the mat and see what happens. Now, the thing is with Trevin Jones, he hasn't fought a lot of good wrestlers or grapplers in his career, so I don't think you can confidently say that he's going to be able to stop takedowns. But even so, the takedowns is from the wrestling perspective. Once he's on the mat, can he get back up to his feet? I think he probably can, because a lot of Lawrence's takedowns, he scores a lot of takedowns because fighters keep getting back up to the feet, is what I'm trying to say. And I think Jones is going to show that he's a better defensive grappler than Vince Cachero and Jose Johnson. So I think Jones is going to get back up to his feet routinely, but I just don't think that the takedowns are going to stop from Lawrence. He won't be deterred by that. And on Trevin Jones's record, he does have a couple of chokes, so you can see that the jiu-jitsu is there, but you do have to question the level of opponents that he was choking out. Now, also on tape, when you dig into his previous fights, the fight before the Timur Valiyev fight against Takafumi Otsuka, deep 89, he was getting thrown about a little bit. Otsuka was closing the distance, scoring a takedown. Trevin Jones was getting back up to his feet, but giving his back to get back up to his feet. That allowed Otsuka to start throwing him around a little bit. These are types of takedowns that Ronnie Lawrence thrives on, that we saw in the Vince Cachero fight when Cachero was getting back up to his feet and giving his back to do so. Ronnie Lawrence was just grabbing the body lock from behind, lifting him up and dumping him on the mat. The exact same sort of takedowns as Otsuka was landing. And then if you do look a little bit further back into ACB, back into the ACB days, Jones fought somebody called Rodrigo Pryor. Pryor, at the end of the first round, he was taken down, but he ended up sweeping Trevin Jones. Jones tried to scramble up to the feet, gave his back again. Pryor ended up taking the back, getting a body lock and holding him down for the remainder of that first round. So these are just a couple of signs that tell me that Trevin Jones can be taken down. He gives his back up when he's trying to get back up to the feet. That's definitely a concern. And the thing is with Lawrence, he's almost got this magnet for top position in scrambles where he's looking like he's about to make a mistake and put himself in a bad position, and then suddenly it's actually just a part of the scramble and he ends up back on top. I think the scrambling and the jiu-jitsu war in this fight is going to be phenomenal to see. But ultimately, I feel that Trevin Jones at the end of this fight is probably going to have been taken down 6, 7, 8 times. And even if Lawrence doesn't do a whole lot with those takedowns, if he scores 2 or 3 and doesn't do a whole lot, then it's likely going to be the striking of Jones that the judges favour. But when it actually gets into the bigger numbers of those takedowns, the judges just can't ignore it. And then when we're looking at the striking, I've seen numerous fights where Trevin Jones is just so inactive with his striking, he's only throwing low kicks. But then in his two fights in the UFC, he's knocked both of his opponents out with big power shots. That's the concern here from Ronnie Lawrence. I actually think Ronnie Lawrence is going to land more volume. I think he's going to be the more dynamic striker. I think he's the better mover with the better footwork. But one thing that I don't like about Ronnie Lawrence is his spin attacks, spin back fist, spin back kicks. And I think that if Jones can time one of those and land a big punch, he could potentially knock Lawrence out. But ultimately, I feel that the best path to victory is that knockout shot of Trevin Jones. I think outside of that knockout shot, I think Ronnie Lawrence is going to be the more effective striker. I think he's going to be landing a lot of takedowns. Not sure there's going to be a ton of grappling, but the takedowns will play a big factor. And I have to favour the fighter outside of that big one-punch knockout shot. I'm picking Ronnie Lawrence to win this fight. And in the final breakdown of this episode, we've got Orion Cosi versus Philip Rowe. Cosi's currently the minus 150 favourite. The comeback on Rowe at plus 130 as the underdog. As for where the value is on the betting line, I think the value sits with the underdog in Philip Rowe at plus 130. I don't think that Orion Cosi is a bad fighter. I just think that Rowe's got a good fight ahead of him, and Cosi shouldn't be a minus 150 favourite in this spot. As for where the betting line moves throughout fight week, a ton of money has come back in on Rowe. Cosi was sitting at around minus 200 a few days ago. All that money's come back in on Rowe, took him from around plus 175 down to plus 130. I agree with that trend. I do think it continues. And actually, as crazy as this sounds, on Wednesday of fight week, it wouldn't shock me for this fight to end up a minus 110 pick'em either come fight night on Saturday night. Now, as for how this fight plays out, again, like I said, I don't think Cosi is a bad fighter, but I was just a little underwhelmed with Cosi. I don't think he's a bad fighter, but I do think he could have given a lot more in his contender series fight, or maybe he just didn't have a lot more to give. He could be developing as well. But what I see from Philip Rowe is just a more technical striker in this fight. I think the fight's actually going to be won and lost on the feet. It wouldn't shock me to see a couple of takedowns. Cosi potentially trying to take Rowe down, but Rowe's got a decent get-up game. Rowe's also got takedowns himself as well. We saw that in his last fight against Gabe Green. The other thing to quickly mention here as well, Orion Cosi, he's standing at 5'11" with a 71-inch reach. And then you've got Phil Rowe with the 6'3" height with an 80-inch reach. So Phil Rowe Rowe is 4 inches taller and he's got 9 inches of reach on Kosi. So what I see happening in this fight is I think Phil Rowe is going to try and strike from the outside. Kosi's got to apply that pressure and constantly be trying to close the distance. But when he gets inside of boxing range, I don't think Phil Rowe is totally outmatched there. I think Phil Rowe could even close the distance even further, get into clinch range where he can frame, land some elbows, land some knees with the length of his body, really drive those torque shots into the body and head of Kosi. I think Kosi, to win this fight, has got to stay inside that boxing range, not further out, not further in, and stay inside of that range for as long as the fight plays out and try and see the fight out. But staying in one single range and being successful with it consistently throughout a 15-minute fight inside a cage is going to be extremely difficult to do. I think Rowe, even inside that boxing range, is not, like I've already said, not completely outmatched. I think Rowe's a better fighter than Kosi, and that's what surprises me, that Kosi is actually a minus 150 favourite in this spot. But I do think that Rowe is liable to get hit a little bit too much. If Kosi can get into a flow of routinely tagging Phil Rowe up, pushing Phil Rowe back, that might make the fight start to go in the favour of Kosi. But I've got to favour the fighter that has been in the UFC already, that's had his UFC debut. Gabe Green's not a bad fighter either, a fighter with good forward pressure and power. And Phil Rowe was able to make that fight close in the end. And when you look at the style of Gabe Green compared to Orion Kosi, they're very similar styles. I just think Gabe Green's a better version of Orion Kosi. Ultimately, I do think Kosi will have moments in this fight for sure, but I think Rowe's going to land more volume. I think he's going to be the slightly more elusive striker. I think he's going to be harder to hit. And I do think that eventually, whether it be a finish or whether it be a decision, Phil Rowe will come out on top. I'm picking Phil Rowe to win this fight. And that's all for this episode of On The Moneyline. I hope you all enjoyed it. And as always, fight fans, I'd appreciate all the likes to the video and subscriptions to our MMA Play 365 YouTube channel too. If I've ever helped you win money, if I've ever helped you with some analysis on one of your picks, I'd really appreciate you just hitting that subscribe button. I really do. Remember, you can get all the betting advice you'll ever need over at MMAPlay365.com. We cater for long-term gamblers that like to build their own bets and strategies, gamblers that just want to follow exactly what I bet on, and we also cater for you fun gamblers that like the long shot fun parlays, or ACCAs, accumulators as we call them in the UK. Even if you only want our best value underdog for the event, which comes with a money back guarantee, we have plenty of different packages and subscription options for you guys to choose from, which also includes our DFS packages for DraftKings and FanDuel as well. All our subscriptions are at very affordable prices. Just hop on to MMAPlay365.com and see what's best for you. Thank you all for listening, and we'll see you at the next event.